Why don't you tell me a little bit about your history and you know, your history in economics, how you got started, and, you know, some key milestones along the way.
Sure. Yeah, I never meant to be an economist. That was kind of an accident. I was, in general, I got good grades, but I was a terrible student in the sense I didn't care at all about learning. I was only strategic. And so when I got to Harvard as a freshman...
When you say strategic, you mean I want to get good grades... Whether I learn anything or not, forget about it.
I was such an anti-intellectual. I just did not care at all about anything except getting my grade at the end. I was completely a means to an end kind of student. And so when I got to Harvard, I decided I'd just take all the easiest classes. And so in my freshman year, everybody was taking Ec 10, the introductory class. So I figured, I had no interest in economics, but I figured I would just take it. And a key moment was maybe on the fourth or fifth lecture. I sat through this lecture, as I had sat through the previous four, and I said, this is just so embarrassing that Harvard is making my parents pay for a class where they just talk about the most obvious things in the world, things I've known since I was 8 years old. And I was walking out of the lecture, my best friend was walking next to me and said, that was the most confusing, impossible lecture I've ever seen in my life. How could anyone understand it? I realized at that moment that I actually thought like an economist. I didn't know it, but I still didn't have any interest in economics, but I was smart enough to know I wasn't good at anything else. And so I just decided to be an econ major because I thought like an economist. And then I went to work. I never thought I'd be an academic, and I went to work, and it was interesting. I went to be a management consultant. And what surprised me is when I got away from academics, I actually realized I was an academic. I realized that I liked rigor, I liked ideas, I liked the freedom to think about things. So then I applied to graduate schools, and my only problem was I literally had taken only one math course in my college career. That was Math 1A at Harvard. It was high school calculus because I had gotten a 2 on the calculus AP exam, which was the lowest score that anyone in honors calculus had ever done in my high school. So I had no mathematical preparation. But I didn't know. I was so out of it, I didn't even know that you needed to know math to do academic economics. So I applied to schools, and I got into MIT. And I had such a rude awakening when I got to MIT because I didn't even know what a partial derivative was. And so every day, you know, I had never taken linear algebra. So you can imagine trying to do econometrics without having the basic rudiments of it. And so I pretty much kind of staggered through graduate school. And it was really good in a way, though, because all of my peers spent all their time on the math of problem sets, and I didn't understand the math. So I learned some of the math, but really I thought. I really tried to understand economic intuition, and in the end, I think that really paid off for me because I really emphasized intuition. So I managed to get through MIT and then went to the Harvard Society Fellows, where I did a 3-year postdoc. And then I came to Chicago Department of Economics.
We'll stop you here, because I want to go back to where you started, which is you said, well, I was the least academic, and you just cared about means to an end. I wanted to get good grades, I wanted to be successful in school, and I didn't care whether I learned anything. Was that true outside of class? In your everyday life, were you also very non-analytical, or did you make an effort to understand the world around you?
Yeah, I was incredibly analytical. So when I was 8, now I think I was 7, so my dad had a huge influence on me. For instance, he liked to trade options, like stock options. And so my job as a 7-year-old was when he got the Wall Street Journal in the mail every day. And my job as a 7-year-old was to study the options page and look for potential butterfly trades that we could make. So at the age of 7, I was thinking very analytically. I think when I was 8 or 9, I undertook a study of correlations in baseball. So I basically went through year by year. I had an almanac of all the baseball outcomes for each team for each year. And I pairwise correlated number of wins with each of the inputs, strikeouts, home runs. So I was 8 or 9 using a scientific calculator where I had to type in the vector of wins and the vector of the things and then like hit return to get the correlations. And then when I was in high school, I fell in love with the racetrack, and I built, you know, primitive computer programs that were processing huge amounts of data to try to beat the racetrack.
Were you analytical in terms of how you organize the world around you? That is, thought about, well, geez, why is the world look the way it does? Why do I see? Can I understand how things work? Did that grow come out early, or did that come later?
I'm not sure that ever came. I think the way I think about the world is actually somehow intensely centered around myself. I think I'm good at using economics in a very personal, individual way, and much less good, I think, at understanding big systems and government. Maybe this isn't even a good example, but I'll give you another example. When I was about 12 or 13, I was just a really unlikable kid in many, many dimensions. I was not only shy, but I was like kind of arrogant and insecure. And I had an older sister, Linda, who was like a super creative genius, the most creative person I've ever known. And I said to her, hey, I'm just looking at the way I'm managing the world is like totally ineffective. I would like you to completely recreate my personality for me. I'm gonna hand it over to you. You can tell me what I should do, how I should act, what I should wear. And she did, and we went on this massive experiment in which she just basically every day gave me instructions about how to be like a more likable person.
So but that tells me you were very analytical in the sense I was talking about, because most people would never have even thought to ask that question, would never have thought about, hey, maybe I should reweight myself at 13, right? Nobody thinks about the world that way.
I do believe I think differently than other people, but somehow it's in a way that is more, somehow it's, I think a lot of economists are somehow more abstract than I am. Like you can think about the market for energy and understanding how, well, there's oil and there's substitutes and there's delaying. You're really good at like a very complex system and how economics plays. I think my version of economics is somehow very simple. It's about there's a problem or there's a question, and then almost always the question is, so how can I, through a mix of theory and data, answer usually but a simple question. Like it's usually like how big is some parameter, not, you know, how does the world work? So I don't know, I'm not sure if that's a true distinction or not, but that's kind of what I think I've been good at, is if I can find the right question, I kind of find the back door into trying to figure out how to answer it.
But I think finding the right question, or right question is probably not even the right term, finding the question is something I think I at least would associate with Steve Levitt. That, you know, Steve Levitt is really good at finding the question that maybe people didn't even think was a question. Your experience at 13 kind of fits with that, that most people wouldn't have even have thought, like, gee, should I remake myself along these lines? And should I go to my sister and ask for help in doing that? I mean, wow, how many people think like that? And so the idea that you could remake yourself, the idea that your sister could help you do that, and to me is like asking a question and looking in a direction that maybe other people don't think to look in. And after the fact, you say, well, of course, she's very successful on these dimensions. Why wouldn't you ask her? Well, most people don't think the world that way. And when I look at your research career and your career kind of on the more public front, it seems to me you've done that numerous times of sort of saying, you know, geez, there's this cool question that has been sitting right in front of us and nobody's asked. And I agree, it could be a very simple question, but a big part of the insight is thinking to ask it.